Not mathematics, but actually the paper looks like more mathematics than computer science. But actually this is how the future of computer science will look like, because this topic is about quantum computing. The title of the paper is Reading a Single Qubit System Using Weak Measurement with Variable Strengths. Let's introduce the problem in the beginning. Anyone with a basic background in quantum mechanics will know that we can read information about any unknown quantum system using sharp measurement or projective measurement. And we all know that sharp measurement is an irreversible operation where applying a sharp measurement on a qubit will make the superposition collapse to one of the two possible states in a probabilistic way. For example, if we have a quantum system like this, cosine phi 0 and sine phi 1, if we apply projective measurement on this system, then the superposition will collapse to either 0 with probability cosine squared phi or to 1. Actually, in quantum computing, we don't want this to happen because it means that our quantum data is destroyed because of measurement. So in this paper, I'll try to fix this problem in a different way. So now, what we are going to do in this paper is that if we have an unknown qubit system, it is required to know how close the qubit to either 0 or 1 without too much disturbance to the superposition. So we don't want to break the superposition as is a sharp measurement. No sharp measurement is allowed on the unknown qubit itself, as we are going to see. So this paper will propose a quantum algorithm to read the information content of this unknown qubit system without applying any sharp measurement on the qubit. In this paper, a quantum feedback control system will be introduced where sharp measurement will not be applied on the unknown qubit itself, but it will be applied on some auxiliary qubits will be used temporarily during the algorithm. This temporary qubit will be made weakly entangled with the unknown qubit we want to read. It will be shown that we can count the outcomes from the sharp measurement on the auxiliary qubit, not on the qubit itself, and we can read the information this way. The first interesting feature in this algorithm is that this quantum measurement process is reversible. It can be reversed. Not like the sharp measurement, which is a reversible operation. Actually, we can also define or control the strength of this weak measurement. We can make it as weak as we want or as strong as we want. We can change the strength of this weak measurement as we're going to see. So let's start before seeing the algorithm. We have to make some setup. Actually, the main idea comes from the partial negation operator. If we start with the Pauli X operator, if we take the C's root for this Pauli X operator, we will get a matrix like this. If this matrix is applied for d times on any qubit, so it is equivalent to applying this operator to that qubit, such that if d is equal to c, then we get x. So as if we are going to divide the Pauli X gate to c steps. Then we defined an operator, MX operator, using this V gate. It's just a series of a cascading of control V gates, followed by measurement, then a reset operator. Now, if we apply MX operator on this quantum state, we will get a state like this. The extra qubit will be in this state. D here we will define as the one density of the vector x0, x1 to xn minus 1. One density here means how many qubits in this system equal to 1. So this is the one density of the quantum state. Now, if we apply measurement on these auxiliary qubits, then we will find 0 with this probability and find 1 with this probability. This is not the algorithm, it's just a setup to the algorithm itself. The algorithm starts with register preparation. Given an unknown qubit system, we will add mu plus 1 qubits. Mu plus 1 qubits and new qubits are all initialized to state 1, and the extra qubit is initialized to state 0, which we will use it as an auxiliary qubit. So our system now is the unknown qubit system plus new qubits or initialized one plus extra qubit. We are going to use it during the run of the algorithm. So the quantum system now as follows contains of mu plus two qubits as a tool. If we apply now nx on this system, then we will get a system like this. Here d0 is the one density of the vector psi 0 and d1 is the one density of the psi 1. So d0 differ from d1 only by 1, which is the one state from the psi. Now if we apply measurement on this extra qubit, then we will have the summation 0 from here and 0 from here plus the cosine phi and sine phi, which is unknown. So the probability of Ax will be equal to this equation, and probability of Ax equal on Ax is the auxiliary qubit, not the unknown qubit itself. We are going to iterate the algorithm, applying Mx for j times, just an iteration operation. So now we'll define two counters. I will assume that J0 counts how many one we find Ax equals 0. And sorry, J0 counts how many times we find Ax equals 0. J1 counts how many times we find Ax equal 1. We are going to count the outcomes from the Ax, not the unknown qubit itself. So the iterative version of the algorithm can be seen like this. Alpha J extended equal alpha J psi 0 psi beta J psi 1. This is a probability of Ax equal 0 and Ax equal 1, such that if we find, each time, if we find Ax equal 0, then the system will be updated to this formula. And if we find Ax equal 1, then the system will be updated to this formula. This is a recurrence relation. We need to solve this recurrence relation so we can study the behavior of the algorithm. So this is the solution of the recurrence relation. Now, this is the four master equations of the algorithm. This is the probability of finding Ax0 after j iterations. This is the probability of finding Ax equal 1 after j iterations. This is psi 0 and psi 1 after j iterations. We are trying, we have to remember that we are trying to minimize the disturbance to reproduce system. So we need to make this value as close as possible to cosine phi, cosine square phi after the end of the algorithm, and this value to still as close as possible to sine squared phi by the end of the algorithm. This is just a summary of the algorithm. Now we prepare the system. We initialize two counters, J0 and J1, and then we apply MX operators for R times. This is arbitrary. We can choose it as much as we want. And every time we apply measurement on AX, and if AX equal 1, we increment the counter of J1. And if we find AX equal 0, then we increment J counter. By the end of the run, if J1 greater than J0, then we will assume that the qubit is closer to the state 1. Else the unknown qubit is closer to the state 0. We are going to trace this algorithm now and understand how it works. Before we start tracing, analyzing the algorithm, the first aim of the algorithm to make the measurements on the auxiliary qubit has a weak effect on the probabilities of psi, which is, this is weak measurement we mean in this paper. Actually, this can be done by setting C in Mx such that C greater than D1. Actually, any value will do, such that if we find Ax equals 0, psi 1 will not disappear from the system. One more benefit from using weak measurement, that weak measurement actually is not like projective measurement. Weak measurement can be reversed. It is a reversible operation, not like the projective measurement. The second aim is to find J0 greater than G1, the counters, J0 greater than G1, if cosine square phi greater than sine square phi, and vice versa. So this counter will give me an indication if sine square phi greater than cosine square phi or not. To achieve this, we will try to make probability of Ax equal 1 equal to probability of Ax equal 0 equal half. This is in the beginning, such that the impact of the unknown phi appeared in the probability of Ax. So if